Friends, good evening and welcome to the first of our Holy Week services. We're delighted that you're able to join us and we do pray that these would be a really special time each evening as we gather together in our separate homes to worship God and to journey with Jesus through this week. We're going to start with an opening prayer, the words for which will appear on the screen in front of you. In the stillness of this evening, may your voice alone be heard. In the quietness of your presence, may we hear God's living word. In the oneness of the Spirit, we would wait upon you, Lord. In the stillness of this evening, may your blessing be outpoured. Amen. We're going to sing together, and the words for our opening hymn will appear on the screen in front of you. Please do join in wherever you are. Luke 19,
verses 28 to 44. After Jesus had said this, he went on ahead. He was going up to Jerusalem. He approached Bethphage and Bethany. The hill there was called the Mount of Olives. Jesus sent out two of his disciples. He said to them, "Go to the village ahead of you. As soon as you get there, you will find a donkey's colt tied up. No one has ever ridden it. Untie it and bring it here. Someone may ask you, 'Why are you untying it?' If so, say, 'The Lord needs it.'" Those who were sent ahead went and found the young donkey. It was there just as Jesus had told them. They were untying the colt when its owners came. The owners asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" They replied, "The Lord needs it." Then the disciples brought the colt to Jesus. They threw their coats on the young donkey and put Jesus on it. As he went along, people spread their coats on the road. Jesus came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives. There the whole crowd of disciples began to praise God with joy. In loud voices they praised him for all the miracles they had seen. They shouted, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. May there be peace and glory in the highest heaven." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd spoke to Jesus. "Teacher," they said, "tell your disciples to stop." "I tell you," he replied, "if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out." He approached Jerusalem. When he saw the city, he began to weep. He said, "I wish you had known today what would bring you peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes. The days will come when your enemies will arrive. They will build a wall of dirt up against your city. They will surround you and close you in on every side. You didn't recognize the time when God came to you, so your enemies will smash you to the ground. They will destroy you and all the people inside your walls. They will not leave one stone on top of another." Amen. There are only two recorded occasions of Jesus weeping. The shortest verse in Scripture, John 11, 35, Jesus wept. And then here in Luke chapter 19. Jesus wept at the graveside of his close friend Lazarus. Well, we get that. We've all done that. The agony of bereavement moves even the toughest soul to tears. Those who are grieving today probably know the added pain of not having been beside a loved one as they died. They have to plan a funeral where only a handful of people are permitted to attend. Their weeping is magnified, but all of us have wept at a graveside. But in this evening's passage, Luke tells us that Jesus wept over a city, and that's not so common. Well, maybe until now. We look around our village, our nation, this world, and if we're not moved in some way, then we are blind to the tragedy. The tragedy of thousands of deaths. The tragedy of families torn apart. The tragedy of livelihoods destroyed. The tragedy of overstretched professionals making the ultimate sacrifice in caring for the sick. The tragedy of young people missing out on final exams, graduations. The tragedy of children not being able to play with their friends. The tragedy of church buildings closed. Look at our village. Look at our country. Look at our world and weep. Jesus wept over Jerusalem because he knew their choices then, at that point, would lead to utter disaster in the future. Within 40 years, Jerusalem was destroyed. The people were decimated, and those who survived became fodder in the Roman Empire. Perhaps you're weeping because you see the choices some people are making in ignoring social distancing. And their choices now affect all of us for the foreseeable future. But I wonder, do we also weep because as we look around, and maybe we have more time to do that these days, we see so many of those we love, care for, work alongside, socialise with, so many who are facing life without Jesus. They maybe don't know much about him, who he is, what he's done for us. Or maybe they do, and they've chosen to reject him. Is your heart breaking? Do you weep for those who are lost without the Saviour? Jesus weeps. This is his triumphal entry, and he enters Jerusalem with a tear-stained face. He would go through the following days, living and dying, so that the people of Jerusalem and the people of Milton of Campsie could be saved. As we weep, may we also thank him for all he has done and is doing. And let's keep praying. Let's keep sharing the good news of Christ till all those that we love can shout, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord." Let us pray together. Lord, we look at our hands. It was hands like ours that were nailed to the cross. Lord, we look at our feet. It was feet like ours that stumbled their way to Calvary. Lord, we think of the faces of those we love. It was for them that Jesus was crucified. Lord, we look at ourselves. It was for us that Jesus died. We bring you our praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Our final hymn is a new one, and one that we hope you enjoy singing throughout this week, God's Own Son. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, evermore. Amen.